Amen. Good morning, church.
Good morning, Jim.
I'd like to welcome you to Community United Methodist Church this morning, whether you're worshiping in your pew or at home on your couch. We hope that it's meaningful to you this morning. A few announcements. Bell practice has begun every Thursday. Contact Shelley if you're interested in helping out with the bells. Kentucky Mountain Mission Truck will be here the week of February 1st through the 5th. That's when you can bring the donations. So if that New Year's cleaning out of the closets occurred, bring those donations for the Mountain Mission Truck the first week of February. Now at this time, I'd like to call Dr. Alan Stewart forward about an announcement about using the pavilion here at the church. So Dr. Stewart.
Thank you for having me here today. It's an honor to be able to worship with you. I will warn you, I'm going to speak a little bit about COVID. And when I get going, I tend to be like a minister. I'm sometimes a little bit hard to get the microphone back from, but I'll try to be brief. My real purpose today is to come here to say thank you from the bottom of my heart for this congregation allowing us to use your community center as the center for our public health clinic for the vaccine program. We will be opening the clinic tomorrow morning, and we attempted to find a site that would be appropriate, and we looked at our office at the public health office on Fifth Street. It simply was not going to be big enough. I'm not sure if you're aware of this, but Howard Hatcher is our emergency preparedness person. And we have sites in the community that have already been identified that would be appropriate for emergency use. And your community building has been identified as what we call a POD site, P-O-D. That stands for point of dispensing. And that is exactly what this is for. I'm not sure if it was used for the H1 flu pandemic, but it is going to be used for our COVID pandemic. And when Howard went to, I believe, Braddale to ask if we could use that center, the answer simply was yes. There was not hesitation. It was not how much rent can you give us, what can you do for us. It was simply yes, and for that we are grateful. Now we do have some funds that we'll be able to compensate you for it, and we would like to do that, but it's a little bit tricky being a government entity to assist you in doing that. But on the other hand, I have several people on our staff who do a good job with government speak, and we will try to do that. But I'm not sure. I am a lifelong Lutheran, and I do worship down the street at 10th and Broadway. And I'm not sure if you use the same vernacular here as we do in the Lutheran church. But when something like this happens, we have a name for it, and we simply call it divine intervention. And we thank you very much for this. To give you a little bit of an update as to where we stand with this, as you know, we have a vaccine coming. We have 700 doses, and we anticipate a good flow of vaccine. The hospital clinic has been open, and they've been doing an outstanding job. The state has elected to serve people by our most vulnerable people, who seem to be the oldest people, and then working their way down. We have been in contact with the state as far as groups who are considered essential workers, and in a direct conversation with Dr. Box, who's the head of the Public Health Association in the state, she said, you can't imagine all the essential workers, and there'd be no way as a politician to be able to prioritize that. So we're just going by age. As you know, the pandemic has caused a lot of illness nationwide in our community, death, economic hardship, and severe psychological stress. With the advent of the vaccine, we feel we will be able to, over the next several months, put an end to this. Right now, about 9% of our community has been infected with COVID. The hospital has already vaccinated close to 5% of our community. So we're approaching 15% vaccination, and with continued vaccinations, we should be able to start seeing the curve of illness and death going downward. Just a couple of comments on our particular community. Our hospital has done an outstanding job of treating this. We do not have anyone on ventilators at the present time. One of the things that our hospital has done was make use of the monoclonal antibodies, one of which was developed by Eli Lilly in Indiana, and we have been using this aggressively. Just to inform you how this is used, it is used for people over 60 or with complicating illness. You have to have had the illness or symptoms for less than 7 days, and you have to test positive, and you cannot be sick enough to need oxygen or go in the hospital. In other words, we have to catch it at the right time when there is what we call viremia. The virus is in the bloodstream and not yet attached to the lung or the cells or whatever. And I tell you this because it's important to know this, because at the beginning of the pandemic, I would tell people, well, you just have to sit home and hydrate and take Tylenol. But that's not true anymore. We've used this in excess. We are about at 200 doses. And after using this, we have only had one person admitted to the hospital early in using this, and we feel that we have saved a lot of illness and lives. And just to give you an example on how our hospital is doing with this, it has been slow to catch on to the country. And Deaconess Hospital in Evansville has been using this as well, and so have we. And at one time, we had used as much of the monoclonal antibodies as the whole San Francisco Bay Area. And between Deaconess and us, we had used more monoclonal antibodies than the whole state of California. If you can imagine little old Vincennes being that far ahead. Now other areas of the country are catching on and the supply is getting short, but they have been doing a very nice job in staying up to date and preventing illness. I would like to be able to also offer vaccine to members of the congregation, but cannot really do that. Other than the age, if you're 80 and older at the present time, there are two ways I can offer this to you. One is if you are a volunteer for the health department to help in the clinic, you will be eligible to be vaccinated. The other way is that if you, at the end of the day, we have 10 doses in each vial. If we have used up 3 or 4 doses, we have to get rid of those last 6 or 7 doses. And we are keeping a list of people who are interested in being called on short notice, who can hop in their car, get down to the clinic, and get that last dose so that we don't have to throw any away. And I do have a couple of sign-up places here. Please don't feel an obligation to sign up, but if you are interested in either being a volunteer or someone who might be eligible for the last dose, please feel free to sign up. And once again, thank you so much to you. You as a congregation and individuals for volunteering your community center for us. This is going to help our community get better, and it will definitely save lives. So thank you. And if there are there any questions that I can answer for you? Well, that's a really good question. The answer is we don't know yet, just like we don't, if you have had the illness, they say you can consider yourself immune for about 90 days. They're going to have to follow the vaccine to find out how long you stay immune. So that's unknown. Hopefully it will be a rather long period of time. Yes, it does. It's 95% effective. Now, long term, we feel fairly certain that it should be extremely safe. The technique that was used to produce the vaccine actually was developed in my medical school, and it's called an mRNA. And what it does is take just small protein particles of the virus. It does not take the whole virus like the Johnson & Johnson and the other ones. And the body will sensitize itself to these particles. And then when the virus gets in the body, it will produce antibodies and react against it. So while there may be allergic reactions and so forth, we feel fairly strongly that it's going to be extremely safe and not cause any long-term side effects. So that said, you have to wait and see. But I took it myself. I've had my second dose. I had no side effects other than a little bit of a sore arm. And I encourage you all to take it. I think I can tell you, I think it's going to be good, it's going to be safe, and it's going to make us better. Galen. Yes, you can get the vaccine. If you have a history of being allergic, highly allergic to medications, though, we will ask you to go to the hospital to get your dose. And that's right next to the emergency room if you should have an allergic reaction of some type. But it should not have the same sensitivities as the old ones that are either attenuated virus, live attenuated virus, or virus that have merely been broken up and then injected, broken up and killed and injected into people. This is totally different. It's amazing new technology. The clinic is going to run basically from 9 o'clock in the morning to 3 o'clock in the afternoon. We will be open one day on Friday until 7 p.m. and then Saturday from 10 to 2. Scheduling the clinic will depend upon our flow of vaccine. Right now we have 700 doses and hopefully we'll get a continued. They've asked us how much we want. We want 700 doses a week. Again, that will depend upon how it's distributed. To sign up, you can sign up on a website called Our Shot. That's OURSHOT.IN.gov. And it will ask you your zip code, and then our clinic site should pop up on it. And you will not be able to sign up until you are eligible. In other words, over 80 years old, a healthcare worker, first responder, something like that. Yes? I would say it is safe. If you have a lot of allergies, as I said earlier, I would suggest you get your shot from the hospital. Yes? Yes, when you get your first shot, you will automatically get an appointment for your second shot. Yes, and you want to take the same type of vaccine. The hospital at the present time is just doing Pfizer, we're just doing Moderna. Yes, the Pfizer is 21 days and the Moderna is 28 days separated. It's extremely important. Now, the younger people will probably get a 40 to 50% immunity with the first dose, but the second dose is important. The reason, there's been a lot of controversy you'll see on the news, like I think California and President-elect Biden wants to release all of the reserve stockpiles and so forth. That's anticipating that we'll have a continued flow. Let's say we're a little late on the second dose. Theoretically, and from scientific experience, that should be okay. The problem is that the studies were done with the 21-day and the 28-day distance between them. So the safest way to do it to get the best results is to do it exactly that way. And so that's why we're trying to continue to do that. Again, thank you very much. I'll look forward to worshiping with you, and I'll
thank you, Dr. Stewart. We sure appreciate your help on that. So now let's go before the Lord and pray, shall we? Good morning, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Lord, we thank you again for another day that you have created, another opportunity to gather together in your presence. Lord, as we lay our concerns and our heart before you, we ask, God, that you would speak to us today in a unique and special way. You know each of our cares, you know each of our concerns, you know our needs, and you know the things, Lord, that we need to hear to get us on fire for you. So, Lord, here we are. Speak to us. Into your hands we commit our spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please stand. Let us sing about why we are here and what we are to do while we are in this place.
Your glory, God, is what I
Please be seated. Amen. We've reached that time in the service for joys and concerns. While he's here with us, I'd like to just thank Dr. Stewart for sharing your knowledge and the unbelievable amount of time that you've committed to our community. So we appreciate that. Thank you. Joys that I think Meredith Hayes has a birthday coming up this week. Is that right? Happy birthday, Meredith. My niece and nephew, the twins, Allison and Graydon, happy birthday to them tomorrow, right? How's studying for that? Okay. Yeah, Allison's getting ready to take her boards in nursing. So yes, Galen, you got your hand up or you just got a stiff shoulder? Okay. Oh my goodness. All right, thank you. Concerns. Shelley Bittner's father passed away in New York. Please pray for Shelley and her family this week. Her address is on the bulletin board by the office if anyone's interested. Pastor Darren's nephew has surgery coming up. Oh, okay. Everything.
We're still waiting to find out the final results. They did end up, he had an infection in his hand. He had cut it at work and it ended up getting infected. It was in the bone of his forefinger and his thumb. And so they took a little of that bone out of there. So he'll be under observation in the hospital for a little bit. We'll see how it goes. So thank you.
All right. And while we're on Pastor Darren, he's having some swelling in his optic nerve. He'll be seeing a specialist tomorrow, kind of distorting his vision a little bit. So we want to keep our pastor in your prayers tomorrow. We'll hope that visit goes well and we can get that fixed up quick. Okay?
Amen.
Tawny's Aunt Pam Cornett. Continue to pray for Lorene and Marion Mason. Ron and Kay Lane, Raymond and Alice Carey, Patty and Jim Dryman, and Wilbur Stewart is now home with hospice. Any more joys, concerns? Yes, Rocky.
I tell everybody what he just said.
Well,
or you didn't,
I didn't hear
either.
Him, so you'll have to share that.
Who was it again?
Wayne McClure.
Wayne McClure.
So he's got a little more cancer treatments.
More cancer treatments, found cancer in the blood.
Okay.
So thanks for sharing that, Rocky. Keep them on our prayer list. Anything else? I wanted to share. It's been an interesting week. And in my readings, this verse hit me at a good time and really stuck with me. It's a pretty good thing to consider this week. Romans chapter 8, verse 38 and 39. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels or demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. I thought that was a great verse to hit me during this time. So please bow your heads and pray with me. Gracious God, the state of our world and our nation concerns us. The history of mankind is recorded in the scriptures. Human history is scarred. But bless and heal this world and our country, Father. May your love comfort every soul as only you can. Bring hope to the hopeless, and please bring unity where there is conflict. Motivate us to work together. Show us our place and guide us to obey your direction. Forgive us for allowing the ways of the world to overwhelm us. Help us to be a consistent source of light for all of those around us. For we know it is only light that will pierce through the darkness. You see us, God. You hear us. You're good and you are fair. You've heard those on our prayer list this morning. You know it's long. Please comfort them and give them strength. And now we lift up the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Now let's take a few moments in and give unto the Lord of our gifts and tithes and offerings. For those who haven't already brought them up, they may at this time. And for those who are doing it otherwise through the mail or through the banking, online and so forth, we give the Lord praise for your generosity and your faithfulness.
Thank you.
Father. Lord, we thank you again for an opportunity to give out of the great and wondrous bounty with which you have filled our lives. Bless and multiply this, Lord, to your service, to the building of your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, if our children like to come down at this time, Cheryl's going to share with you. We got her on this red one here. Come on down. I like that silver coat.
Okay, when y'all come in, just sit on the floor so we stay apart, okay? We're going to stay apart. We're going to stay healthy. Everybody's smiling. You need to sit down there because guess what? I don't want to spit on you. I don't want to make you sick. Even though I'm COVID-free, I've already had it, fought it, bit it, threw it out the door. All right, is that everybody? Good. Okay, well, first of all, I want to talk to you about friends. Any of you have friends? Okay, well, I brought my friend Woody with me today. And one of the theme songs from Toy Story is You've Got a Friend in Me. And Woody says that, doesn't he? Okay. Well, what I want to tell you, first of all, before I share the scripture with you, is that I want you to know that you have a friend in me, and you have a friend in Pastor Darren. Among other people that you know in the congregation, Pastor Darren and I are fairly new. We just got here the first part of July last year. But we really haven't seen you. We've seen your beautiful eyes. And occasionally we sneak and see a little smile out of you. But I want to tell you that Pastor Darren and I are very much looking forward to the day where we can fellowship together, where we can get together, where we can party, where we can smile and laugh and have a great time closer to each other so that we can get to know each other better, because that's what friends do, okay? And I want you to know that if you need to talk, Pastor Darren and I are great listeners. I'm certain that you have friends in the congregation that you've known a lot longer, but we're kind of cool, and we love children, but not in the creepy way. We really do, honestly. I work in a school in the library, and Pastor Darren and I have worked with children for a lot of years, so we do love you. And, you know, our grandchildren are 3.5 hours away, so you can all be our adopted grandchildren, and then that'd be kind of cool, too. So the big thing about being a friend is that you're here for each other, so know that Pastor Darren and I are here for you, okay? And there's actually a scripture that Jesus talks about from the book of John, and it's John 15, 12 through 17, and this is what he said. My command is this, love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that he lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends. So we are friends of Jesus, which means we're friends of God. And there are many, many, many scriptures that talk about being friends with God. And there are also many, many scriptures that talk about being friends in songs. Okay? For everything I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you. Go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. Then the Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. This is my command, love each other. So as we're friends, we love each other, we help each other out, we're there for each other, and it's a really fun time. So, how many of you like the Toy Story movies? Yeah, I do too. The fourth one made me cry. I don't know about any adults out there, fourth one made you cry? Because, hello, it was a little sad. In a happy way. But at any rate, Woody's one of my favorites. And I just want to remind you that friendship is a good thing, and we need to have lots of friends. And yes, even as a child, you can be friends with adults, and that's A-okay. All right? Can you pray with me? All right. I'll say, then you say. Actually, Woody and I'll say, except His squawker's broken, so yeah. Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For the gift.
For the gift.
Of friendship.
Of friendship.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For being.
For being.
Our friend.
Our friend.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Okay. You guys can go to prayer and praise.
As we prepare for Pastor Darren to bring us the word, please join with us in this song.
Shelter of the Lord, who abide in his shadow.
baptism, the Holy Spirit, and fire. What does all of that mean? How did it apply to Jesus? How does it apply to us? Well, let's take a look here. We're going to be in Matthew chapter 4. And if we look at verse, I want to start in 3, verse 13. I don't know, maybe I got this stuff written wrong here, 11 and 12. Let me see. There we go. Yeah, I knew there was another one in here. Thank you. All right. I'm looking at the notes on the screen in case you're wondering what happened there. So back in chapter 3, we start here at verse 11. It says, I baptize you with water for repentance. This, of course, is John the Baptist speaking. But he says, but one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I'm not worthy to carry his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will clear his threshing floor and will gather his wheat in the granary, but the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire. Now think about this. Folks have been coming out to hear John the Baptist, and he's been preaching repentance, being baptized to repent of their sins. Their whole process here was about repenting and then entering into that water as a sign that they are renewing their life before the Lord to wash away their sin. They're waiting for that coming of Christ. They're preparing themselves for when he gets there so that they can continue this process. It's about making themselves ready for Jesus. I baptize you with water for repentance. But one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I'm not worthy to carry his sandals, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. Imagine that. The Holy Spirit and fire filling up the lives of believers. Does that sound in any way, shape, form, or fashion to anybody here, anybody listening, does that sound like a very calm thing? A very passive thing. When you talk about the Holy Spirit and fire, we're talking about something that's exciting, something that's changing lives, something that is empowering, something that is seen and experienced by many all around. Imagine what would happen if every Christian church around the world was filled with the Holy Spirit and fire. Would they look different than many of them do today? Think about that a minute. Holy Spirit, holy fire, people on fire for the Lord. And multitudes are sitting like this. Yeah. Anybody excited by that? Anybody enthused by that? Anybody encouraged by that? Of course not. If we are filled with the Spirit of God, there ought to be a sign of it in our life. People should see and know and experience what God is doing in our lives. They should see that excitement. They should see that hope, that love, that grace. It should be blazing forth from us. But if we walk around like this, hide our faith, keep it closed up, we don't want to insult anybody, don't want to offend anybody. Heaven knows we shouldn't say Jesus out loud in public. Somebody might look at us. Oh, that offends me. I don't care. Jesus didn't care. It offended people. He told them the truth. They were allowed to receive it as they wanted. They were allowed to reject it as they wanted. It was their choice. But he gave them a choice. They had an opportunity to hear. They had an opportunity to experience. But if we're not willing to share that, if we're not willing to give people an opportunity to experience what God's doing in our life, why in the world would they want to come and see what we're doing anywhere else? They don't. We have to know it. We have to experience it. That way, when we share it, other people are going to catch on to that excitement and go, you know what? There must be something going on over there. There must be something to what they've experienced because I can see something different in their life that I haven't seen before. How many of us have tried out a new restaurant because we kept hearing all these great reviews from friends and family? How many have bought different products because they've heard other people that they know, people that they trust, give a good testimony about that product or its quality or what it does? If we're willing to do that for stuff, how much more should we be willing to do that for God? See, if we wonder why there aren't more people in the churches, if we wonder why more people don't know Jesus, hey, it's our fault. Because we haven't been telling them much. You know, it's like to be in a community where the major part of the community understands the church as being that group of people over there that they keep to themselves. They're their own little special group, and they always fight amongst themselves. Oh, yeah. It happens all the time. All over the place, across the denominations. There's nobody left out of that. A lot of communities. And what's worse is those places where they go, oh, well, I don't know why they bother to go to any of those churches because they're just fighting with each other. People following the same Jesus. And they can't get along. Why do I want to be a part of that? We have to give folks a reason to look into what God is doing. We have to show them by our lifestyle. We have to show them by what we do, what we say. And we have to be equipped to say, hey, I know Jesus. Let me tell you what he's done for me. That's what that whole Holy Spirit is about, that Holy Spirit and fire. So let me ask you, is the fire of God burning in your heart today? One of the prophets said, hey, I'd like to stop talking about it because every time I do, I keep getting in trouble. People want to get rid of me. People are trying to kill me. People are trying to run me off. But I can't stop talking. It burns within me so much. I cannot stop. That's the power of God burning in us that won't let us shut up, won't let us sit down, won't let us stop talking about it because we got to shout it out from the highest mountaintops through every valley, mountain, wherever we are, that Jesus Christ is Lord of all. And he offers us redemption, forgiveness, and new life. This is what Jesus came to do. And he came, now hear this. He came with his winnowing fork in his hand. He's just getting started. And already he's getting ready to cut bait. In other words, either you're in or you're out. Are you going to follow him or you're not? If you're not going to, fine. I'm moving on, Jesus said. And that which doesn't come with me is going to get burned up. He's clearing his threshing floor. He will gather his wheat, but the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire will not be put out. Now, this isn't the only place he talks about this. If we go to the book of John, chapter 15, verse 5 and 6, Jesus says this, I am the vine and you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them will bear much fruit, because apart from me you can do nothing. And let's remind ourselves again, if we are the branches and we're bearing fruit, what does God want us to produce? More what? Christians, more believers, amen? If we're not doing it, guess what? We're one of the dead branches. Ruh-roh. Anybody here want to be a dead branch? I don't know about you, not what I'm looking to do. Whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like a branch and withers. Such branches are gathered and thrown into the fire and burned. Matthew 25, verse 31 through 34. When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all his angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand, the goats on his left. And then the king will say to those at his right hand, come, you who are blessed of my father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. So there's going to be a judgment. There's going to be a separation. Those who follow and those who don't. Those who produce and those who don't. There's a kingdom waiting for those who are following Christ and being productive and growing more Christians. And then there's the final lake of fire, where it's all burned up, thrown in. Revelation chapter 20, verse 11 and 5 through 15. Then I saw a great white throne and the one who sat on it. The earth and the heaven fled from his presence, and no place was found for them. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and the books were opened. Also another book was opened, the book of life. The dead were judged according to their works, as recorded in the books. The sea gave up the dead that were in it. Death and Hades gave up the dead that were in them, and all were judged according to what they done. All were judged according to what they had done. Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And anyone whose name was not found written in the Lamb's book of life was thrown into the lake of fire. So there is a consequence for what we do. There is a consequence for what we don't do. So we can worry about hurting other people's feelings by sharing the gospel openly and freely. Think that might be insulted by it. Or we can spare their feelings now, and then they can deal with that eternal damnation and fire and brimstone for all eternity. I mean, I wonder which is worse. Being a little uncomfortable now, or being in that lake of fire for eternity and eternally separated from God, knowing that they could have had a chance. And that's our responsibility, every one of us. We are all held accountable to what God has placed before us to share, to do, to be. But this is the whole purpose of the Holy Spirit. One, that we could be forgiven, then we could be filled and set on fire for God. If we move along here. So then in verse 13, then Jesus came from Galilee to John at the Jordan to be baptized by him. John would have prevented him, saying, I need to be baptized by you. You do, and do you come to me? But Jesus answered, let it be so. Jesus willingly lowered himself, put himself in the position of the servant, put himself in the position of the lowest in order to fulfill God's will. Are we willing to fulfill God's will? Are we willing to humble ourselves to allow God to use us in any way he wants? Or do we have our own plans and our own desires and our own things that we want to do? And if that matches up with God, oh, cool. Tell you, God's not into that. He said, let it be so now, for it is proper for us in this way to fulfill all righteousness. Then he consented. So then, when Jesus had been baptized, just as he came up from the water, suddenly the heavens were opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting on him. And a voice from heaven said, this is my Son, my beloved, with whom I am well pleased. God is pleased with those who say yes. God is pleased with those who will say, Lord, send me, I will go. What do you want me to say? I'll say it. What do you want me to do? I'll do it. Doesn't matter whether it's uncomfortable. Doesn't matter whether it's easy. Doesn't matter whether it's hard. He's looking for folks who will say, yes, I'll do it. Blessed is this one. This is my Son. This is my beloved. He is the one in whom I am well pleased. In some ways, that's kind of a It's not a very exciting statement. You know, you can imagine one of your parents. You've worked all day. You've done all this stuff around the house, trying to do stuff to please your folks or please your boss. And then somebody comes around, and then they come around later and say, thanks, I'm well pleased. That's cool, thanks, I'm pleased. Really, that's it? No high five. No celebration. No employee of the month. No, I'm just pleased. Is it enough for us? Is it enough for each of us to please God? Is that reward enough? It should be. So we move into chapter 4. So now Jesus has been baptized. Verse 4, or chapter 4, he says, then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. So he's been filled with this Holy Spirit, and now the Spirit says, hey, come here, Jesus, I got a place where I need you to go. He's going, why? No, there's no why. He's not asking why. He's just going. He didn't stop and have a conference. He didn't stop and pray. The Holy Spirit said, come on, we're going. And Jesus said, okay. And off he went. He went into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. And he fasted for 40 days and 40 nights. And afterwards, he was famished. Now, there's an understatement. 40 days, 40 nights, fasting, and he's famished. I'd have been starving. Anybody ever fast before? More than just overnight for your med check the next day? I've done some fasting over the years. I think the most I've done, I think it was like 7 days. And it's interesting, when the Lord leads you into a fast and you're going by his will, it's amazing how much you're not really worried about eating anymore. But I can tell you this, on a normal basis, I've had breakfast in the morning, maybe 6, 7 o'clock, 11 o'clock, I'm hungry. I want to eat. My family will tell you, whenever we're going anywhere, one of the first questions I ask, okay, so when are we eating? Doesn't matter if we're on the road, doesn't matter what's going on, what are we? We just had lunch. I know, but supper's about 6 hours away, and we need to be ready. Pastor gets hungry sometimes. A lot. So he's led up into this, led by the Spirit into the wilderness. He's been fasting. He's famished. And then the tempter comes. Satan comes to himself. Not a demon, not some lackey, but the enemy himself, the great dragon, comes before him. And he says to him, if you're the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread. See, sometimes we get tempted by all kinds of stuff. But has the enemy himself ever come up next to you and said, hey, I got something for you? See, we think we have it tough. Here he is, physically at his weakest, although spiritually at his strongest. The enemy comes after him to try to hit him in those weak areas. And guess who knows every weak spot you got? The enemy. He knows. He knows. And those are the things he's going to tempt us with. But Jesus answered him, one does not live by bread alone. This has been written in the scripture, he says, but we live by every word that comes from the mouth of God. Well, that didn't dissuade the devil. He took him to the holy city, placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against the stone. That just seemed like a stupid thing to do. Hey, God, guess what? Catch. Maybe you remember your kids doing that to you when they were little and you took them in the pool. And they'd jump in and then yell to you after they're halfway there. What? But Jesus responded to him, again it is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test. See, Jesus wasn't worried about whether God would do what God said he would do. That was not an issue for him. He trusted and he believed in him. And so he had no reason to test. Well, God, if you say you're going to do it, let's show me, prove it. But he said, nope. Do not put the Lord your God to the test. Now, not dissuaded here, again, the devil took him to a very high mountain, showed him all the kingdoms of the world and the splendor, and he said to him, all of these things, all of these kingdoms I will give you if you will just but fall down and worship me. See, here's the part where I think Satan's kind of stupid. If he knows all about God, knows all about Jesus, he already knows God and Christ, they created the world. So he's actually trying to offer him something he had a hand in making. Technically, he's trying to offer him something he already has access to. Not much of a temptation. But for the flesh, power, money, control. Oh, yeah. Everybody likes a little more of that, don't we? I will give you all of these things if you will just but fall down and worship me. And Jesus said, away with you, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him. So here, think about these temptations now. Again, Jesus at his weakest in some ways from a physical standpoint, he's offered food. Satan's going to give him what his body needs. He offers him a chance to test. Do you really believe God? Do you really trust him? Will he really take care of you? Will God really answer my prayers? Will God really take care of me? Will God really provide everything I need? If I knock, will he really open the door? And then he offers him power. He offers him wealth. And we could go through a long laundry list of things in our own lives where Satan has offered us similar things. Security, provision, financial stability, power, position. But Jesus walked away from it all. He said, get away from me, Satan. I worship the Lord and I worship the Lord alone. That's who I'm going to listen to. That's who I'm going to follow. And I don't care what the rest of the world's doing. I don't care what you're doing. I don't care what you're offering because I don't need what you have because I've already got everything I need in God. That is the power of the Holy Spirit to be able to stand up to those temptations. And just as a side note, we know God also tells us that we are never going to be tempted beyond what we're able to stand, that God provides us a means to avoid those temptations, to walk away from them. He gives us the strength to say no. Then verse 11. Then the devil left him, and suddenly the angels came and waited on him. In his need, after going through all of this, God ministered to him. He sent somebody to help deal with his issues, mind, body, spirit. They were there to minister to Jesus and to help lift him up again, to reassure him, to provide whatever it is he needed. Now, after Jesus had been baptized, filled with the Spirit, led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted, if we jump to the book of Luke real quick in chapter 4, verse 14 and 15, we find this. Then Jesus, filled with the power of the Spirit, returned to Galilee. And a report about him spread through all the surrounding country. He began to teach in their synagogues and was praised by everyone. So he was filled with the Spirit, he was led by the Spirit, and then he was empowered by the Spirit. Jesus didn't begin his ministry without being prepared. God did not send him out there without providing for him everything he needed. Filled with the power of the Spirit, Jesus began his journey to the cross. He did all of that for us. Providing us the opportunity and the means to repent of our sins, be led and filled with the Spirit, and then be empowered by the Spirit to then go and do, to be on fire. Imagine trying to heat your home. You get the fireplace all set up. Got the wood all cut, all set up in there. Families gathered around. It's cold outside. And we all huddle around the logs and the kindling. And we watch. How's it for you? How's it for you? Well, I don't know. It's so cold. Hey, Dad, maybe we should light the fire. Maybe we should keep putting some stuff on the fire so it'll keep burning. Yeah. See, it doesn't make any sense for us to sit around a fireplace filled with wood thinking it's going to heat us if we don't bother to set the thing on fire. God is not expecting us to go out and set the world on fire just by being a bunch of logs. He wants us to be on fire. He fills us with the Spirit. So we repent, we ask him into our heart, he gives us the Spirit. Now that that Spirit's there, that Spirit's empowering us, what do we do with it? Are we sharing the good news? Are we excited about what we know? Are we excited about that text we just read earlier that day in our Bible? Are we excited about that Sunday school lesson we heard, a song on the radio that spoke of Christ and his grace? Are we sharing those things with others, or do we keep them to ourselves? Generations, you've heard me say this before, generations grew up in a time when the church was told, hey, we keep our religion to ourselves. Think about that. Jesus and his disciples all sitting around, Jesus teaching and talking, feeding the thousands. And then he says, okay, now, don't tell anybody because this is all private. This is personal, so we can't share this. We wouldn't be here today. And yet, it almost became institutional in so many churches around the world that we keep our faith to ourselves. It's politically correct. It keeps everybody happy. It doesn't insult anybody. And yet, we're assaulted by the things we see and hear on TV all the time that tell us that anything and everything is okay to do or say or believe. That's okay. I don't think so. God has sent us that Spirit to be on fire for him, to share what we know, to grow in what we know, to continue to seek that faith with one another, to encourage one another, iron sharpening iron. And then again, being able to go out and share that with other people. That's what God wants us to do. That's what it is to be baptized with the Holy Spirit and with fire. Imagine a church on fire for the Lord. That they can't wait to get out and tell somebody what they heard, what they experienced, how God did something in their life. It's not about buildings. It's not about how we do our worship. It's about what God is doing in our hearts and our lives. That's what we need to be sharing. That's what we need to be doing. That's what we need to be encouraging our family and friends to be about. So, are you filled by the Spirit? Are you on fire for God? If you're not, today's the day to do. Today's the day to decide, yes, Lord, I don't want to be a bystander. I want to be on fire. I want to be excited. I want the world to know that Jesus is my Savior. I want the world to know that he wants to be their Savior too. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we have come from many backgrounds, many experiences, many different things we have faced in our lives. But one thing is true for each and every one of us, that you are the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings. You came into this world in the flesh so that we would be can be forgiven of our sins if we would but repent and ask you into our life to give up our will, Lord, to take on your will, to receive that Holy Spirit which you so faithfully and generously give, to receive that precious free gift of grace that cost Jesus his life, to be washed in his blood, to be renewed, to be born again, to be filled and empowered by the Holy Spirit so that we can go out and share the good news of Jesus Christ. So first, Father, if there's anybody listening right now within the sound of my voice, if they have not given their life to Christ, may we do so right now. Just repeating this prayer, Lord Jesus, I believe you are the Son of God. Forgive me of my sins. Come into my heart. Make me new. Fill me, Lord, with your Holy Spirit. And equip and empower me to follow you and to share that good news. I receive you, Jesus, right now. I receive your Holy Spirit. And I thank you and I love you in Jesus' name. Amen. And Father, for those who already know Jesus, who have already had that Holy Spirit dwelling in them, but maybe, Lord, we've never called upon the power of that Spirit that dwells right there within us. Set us on fire right now, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ. Help us to set aside, Lord, our care. Help us to set aside our concern. Let us set aside, Lord, anything that would inhibit us and hold us back from freely and openly sharing everything and anything you have done in our lives. Everything we've read, everything we've heard, Lord, let it all come flooding out of us now in the name of Jesus. That as we walk out of here, Lord, we do so in the power and light of foot as if we had not been as we had been when we first walked in. Help us, Lord, to walk out on fire. Lord, let the world see what you have done in our hearts and our lives. Let them see, Lord, what you're doing in your churches throughout the world. Your Spirit is alive and well and reaching out to those who are willing to say yes to Jesus. Lord, use me. I want to do your will and not my own. I don't want to live a mundane spiritual life of just existing from Sunday to Sunday to Sunday. I don't want to rest on the laurels of saying, well, I gave my life to Jesus, so at least I have eternal life with him. Lord, I don't want to be amongst those dried up sticks that are going to get thrown in the fire. I want to be, Lord, an active, living branch, a living vine that's producing fruit. Not by my power, not by my strength, Lord, but by your Holy Spirit, by your power, through the blood of Christ. Let us be fruitful, O Lord. Let us be bold in the name of Jesus. And let us speak without shame everywhere we go about the good news of Jesus Christ. And let your light, Lord, that shines within us be seen by others. Lord, draw them in so that they will come and ask us, what is it about you? What is it that you know? What's going on in your life? Because whatever you have, I want to have too. Lord, draw them to us as you're being drawn to you. Help us, Lord, there to be at that door that when they knock, we can show them where it is so they can knock knowing, Lord, you're going to open it for them. And welcome them in and feast with them. Father, in your holy name, we give our hearts, we give our lives, we give you praise. And thank you for setting us on fire for you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Pastor Darren. We're going to close with Waymaker. I don't know if you know this, but this song actually originated in Ghana, and a team of us had gone to Ghana in October, and it just will forever, not just because of its words, which are powerful and beautiful, but because a team of us, all moms, with a boatload of kids, were able to safely, in a pandemic, go to Ghana to share the gospel and receive the gospel while we were there. So it is my prayer that you will join with us in song, but also that you will also feel that equipping to go out and share that gospel and to live the gospel, because God is making a way for you to do that. Please stand.
You never stop working. You never stop.
Now may God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit bless and keep you now and forevermore. Amen and amen.